1-2. Okay, here we go. A quiz debriefing. 27 April. Mostly probability, one personal finance thing, and of course there's always going to be, algebra or something. Next slide. Here we go. Right, so I asked you to do these manually. So make sure you show your work. Always show your work. You show your work for you, too. That helps you organize your thoughts. Plus, and I can still give part marks. So show your work always. Let's go. So calculate manually. Manually means by hand. All right, so don't use a calculator. Here's the formulas. There's the permutation formula. There's the number of ways to arrange n things if you're only going to use r of them in some order. And here's the formula for a combination. That's the number of ways to arrange r things out of a possible n things if you don't care what order they're in. So this is if you care about the order, like lining up at the door. And this is if you don't care about the order, like just a group of things or lottery numbers. You don't care what order they're called in. So 5 permute 3 is going to be 5 factorial over 5 less 3 factorial is going to be 5 factorial divided by 2 factorial. So 5, 4, 3, 2, 1 divided by 2, 1, boom, boom. There you go. You end up with 60. Did you do that? All right, this one. Follow the recipe. It should be in your cheat sheet. 7 factorial divided by 7 less 3 all factorial divided by 3 factorial. So it's going to be, it's kind of fun. 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1 divided by 4, 3, 2, 1 times 3, 2, 1. And let's do some canceling. Bing, bing, bing. Right. So it turns out that you end up with 7 times 5. Notice I forgot to bing this one, right? This one got binged too, didn't it? Right? That 4, 3, 2, 1 canceled that 4, 3, 2, 1. And that makes 6, which canceled that 6. There, that makes more sense, right? Next slide. And how many ways can you rearrange distinguishably? So how many arrangements of the letters in this word TP can be, how can you rearrange them into other words? Well, words in quotes. So other arrangements of letters. You got to use all 6 of them. So you got 6 letters. Now if they were all different, there'd be 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1 ways to do it. But they're not all different. Notice that there's 4 E's. So you got to divide by 4 factorial, because believe it or not, there's 24 ways you can juggle around those E's and nobody would notice the difference. So since groups of 24 of those would all be the same looking word, you got to divide by 24. It's a fact, Jack, right? Boom, boom, answer's 30. There's only 30 ways to juggle those letters around to make other arrangements of letters. What's the probability that if you randomly pulled letters out to make a word, that the word would start with a P? So if we agree that has to be a P, well, then you still got to juggle around the last 5 letters. So let's see. There's the 5 letters, and 4 of them are still the same, right? All you got left here is the T and a whole bunch of E's. So how many ways can you arrange 1 T and 4 E's? Let's see. Well, according to this, there's only 5 ways to do that. 5 words that start with a P. And, well, here they are here, right? There's this word. You could actually list them all. There's only 5 of them. All you're going to do is move that T up and down the line. There's only 5 ways to juggle around the E's and T's if the P has to be at the front. There's the sample space right there. You didn't even need math to do this. You could have just done them all. So it turns out the probability is going to be 5 out of 30, because there's 5 ways to get words that start with P, and there's 30 total ways to make words, so 5 out of 30, or 1 out of 6, or approximately 17% is the answer. So, read and do. Pause this if you want. Slow it down. Cheryl's having a math party. She's got 8 friends. Her mom says she can only have 5 friends come to the party. So how many possible groups of friends can she invite? She's all excited. She's having a math party tonight. Nice. My kind of girl. All right. So let's see how many groups, how many different invitation lists could she have? All right. So here, I'm going to draw my bag of friends. All right. It's always nice to have a bag of friends, right? So there's Elisa, and there's Jessica. Now, she's the troublemaker, right? All right. And then there's Bernice and Carla and Denise, and I don't know, I like these, whatever, right? So there's different people there. So how many ways can she choose her friends? Well, she's got 9 friends, and she's allowed to make a group of 5 of them, so 9 combo 5. It's a combo because you don't care what order they're in. You don't care who comes in the door first. You just want that particular group of friends. So that's what a combo is. There's 126 different party lists she could make. All right. So now, of course, Jessica's not allowed to come. So how many people can she think about bringing to her party? Well, let's see. So she doesn't really have 9 friends she's allowed to invite. She's only allowed to invite 8. So the number of friends is really 8 friends. All right. Now, when I did this slide, I messed it up. So here, it'll be 8 friends here. Just wait for it. Wait for it. Here it comes. Right. I made a boo-boo, so I had to erase it. All right. So I'm still working on B. There we go. All right. So Jessica is not allowed to come to the party, so Cheryl doesn't really have 8 friends. She's only got 7 friends to choose from, and of those 7 friends, she's still allowed to invite 5. It's just she's not allowed to choose Jessica, so Jessica got taken out of the pile. So it turns out there's 21 different groups if there's no Jessica allowed. All right, now let's go on to C. So she's already decided that Elisa, who's her best friend, right? We've already decided Jessica's out of there, right? Jessica's gone. Forget Jessica. Now, we've already decided that Elisa is definitely coming to the party, right? But Jessica's not, right? So they're out of the bin. They're out of the bag. So now she's still got 4 more friends to choose out of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. I had too many to start with. That's why. I was wondering there. That one wasn't there. Right? She didn't have 9. She had 8. She had 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. How did Hannah get in there? Right? There shouldn't have been a Hannah in there. Right? Let's get rid of Hannah. Right? Okay, sorry. Right? That one should never have been there to start with. So I'll get rid of that. All the evidence of that is gone. Kind of helps when you got a bag of friends if you draw them properly. Friends in a bag. All right, so let me delete. Oh, there we go. All right, so she had 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 friends. All right, good. We can start again. Okay, so she's definitely bringing Elisa, and she's not allowed to bring Jessica. So there's really, out of her 8 friends, there's still 6 in the bag. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. You see why it's kind of handy to have your friends in a bag. All right, so what does that mean then? So that means she's got 6 friends, and she's still got to pick 4 more, right? She's already decided that Elisa will not. Elisa's coming for sure. So there's 6 friends left in the bag, and she's still got to choose 4, so it ends up being 15. Oh my goodness. So it does take some thinking. Oh yeah, you got to draw your friends in a bag. Sometimes you make boo-boos, and you go back and you say, oh yeah, okay. So this is why you show your work. If all you do is fling down some numbers, then it's pretty hard to figure out what you're thinking. All right, so that's kind of fun. And everybody's favorite, a little bit of algebra. I mean, sorry about that, algebra. All right, so let's just activate this. I'm not going to talk about this. This is old news. those are the answers. We're well beyond teaching much algebra. The algebra will get better, though. Don't worry. If you do not like algebra, then we will shortly be doing it on a calculator. There's calculators that do algebra very nicely. Everybody's favorite, or second favorite. How many ways to get from P to Q? And, of course, you could just tip the triangle on its side and do what Mr. Pascal figured out. Boom, boom, boom. You're going to make some easts and some south trips. You're going to fill in the numbers there. You're going to add up the places like that. There you go. I think you end up with 1,716 paths. And if you didn't like counting, you could have done it using just numbers. You could have said, well, I've got to make 13 steps, right? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. You got to make 13 steps, and 6 of them have to be to the east, and 7 have to be south. So it's like making a word. It's just like making a word with 6 E's and 7 S's. Except it's a secret instruction, so it's going to be 13 factorial divided by 6 factorial divided by 7 factorial. And when you do all that, guess what the answer is? Oh my goodness, you get the same answer. Wow. Next slide. Now we're going to do it, how many roots go where we're going, but they go through F. Right, so we got to calculate how many of the roots go through F. And we're only allowed to make easts and south moves. All right, there you go. So obviously, if you've got to go to the vendor, then if you walk down this street here, you've obviously missed the vendor. So you won't be allowed walking down here. Otherwise, you missed F. And if you walk along here, you're going to miss the vendor. So you won't be allowed there. So you're kind of constrained or restricted there on what you can do. Fill in the numbers, and then of course the numbers here don't change from the previous ones because there's hidden zeros up here and hidden zeros here, and there you go. I think you end up with like 315 or something. And if you don't like doing it that way, then you could just use some math. So you could say, well, to get from P to this place here, whatever you want to call that, is going to be that many ways. And then to get from this place here to this place is going to be that many ways. Right? Because look, to get from here to here is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 steps. So you got 7 letters. 2 of them have to be easts and 5 of them have to be souths. So there's the number of ways to get to this pinch point, and then you still got to carry on. So then there'd be another bunch of ways. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 steps. 2 of them have to be souths. 4 of them have to be easts. So you do all that fancy math, you end up with 21 times 15, sounds like about 315. Isn't that amazing how you get the same numbers? So what's the probability as you wander towards your friend's house that you happen to pass by this place here? Well, it's going to be the number of ways to wander past it divided by all the possible ways, and it's going to be 18.36%. There you go. And a little bit of probability here. So now instead of counting things and then doing a lot, there are rules for probability. So what's the probability you'll draw out two kings if you replace the card that you took out the first time, right? So you have a well-shuffled deck. You're going to find the probability of drawing two kings with replacement. So you're going to pull out a king and then put the card back, and then pull out a king. Well, there's 4 kings out of 52, so it's 4 out of 52 times 4 out of 52. And when you do all that fancy math, it's 16 out of 2,704. Use the button on your calculator, or just leave it as a decimal, for goodness sake. It ends up being that decimal, and then if you go boom, 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 to to turn it to a percent, you end up with less than 1%. 0.59% is not 59%. This is less than 1%. That's less than a 1 in 100 chance. How about Bravo? Two kings, but this time without replacement. So in other words, you take out the first king, and then you put it in your pocket, and then you reach in for another king. So now there's one less king, and there's one less card. Right? There's that should be a 1. Oh, there we go. Right, so you end up with this fancy fraction. You could reduce that, but you know what? Let's just do decimals. That's all we wanted. Percents. And obviously that's going to be a smaller number because there's less possibility of getting a king since you already took one of them out. It's called dependent probability when that happens. How about Charlie? What's the probability of drawing a diamond on the first draw and then a club on the second? And you're allowed to replace the card. So there's 13 diamonds out of 52 total. And there's 13 clubs out of 52 total. Sounds like about 1 out of 4 times 1 out of 4. That's 1 out of 16. And that's 6.25%. That one's easy. And that's kind of obvious, I think. Delta. Bonus. What is the probability you pull out a king and a diamond? So I didn't say a king first and then a diamond. I just said a king and a diamond. All right, so that's where the tricky bit comes in. So the probability of a king and diamond. Well, there's a 4 out of 52 chance of a king. A 1 out of 4 or a 4 out of... there's 4 suits, so there's a 1 out of 4 chance of drawing a diamond. 13 out of 52. But I said a king and a diamond. I didn't say a king, then a diamond. So it turns out that, how about if I got the diamond first, then the king? Oh, sneaky. So you'd have to double it up. 3.85%. What's the probability of getting 4 kings in a row without replacing? So you're going to pull out a king, stick it in your hand. Pull out a king, stick it in your hand. Pull out a king, stick it. It could happen, you know. Well, it could happen. It's not like it might never, ever happen in your lifetime, but it could happen. Here's the probability, 4 out of 52. Now, of course, the next number is going to be 3 out of 51, because there's one less king and there's one less card. So this is a dependent situation. Then there's 2 kings left, but only 50 cards. And then there's 1 king left, and there's only 49 cards. Guess what your chance of pulling out a fifth king is? Yeah, you guessed it. Anyway, so when you do all this, do this on a calculator, you get a pretty tiny number. And if you convert that into a decimal by knocking off 2 zeros, you end up with that. So it is possible to randomly select 4 kings out of a deck of cards to, you know, and keep them in your hand. But I'll bet you in your lifetime it never happens. It probably won't happen in your family's lifetime. Next slide. And then finally, this is compound interest. So you could do it the old way that we did in grade 11. Essential, bada bing, bada boom. Write down the formula, plug in the numbers. And of course, we're learning a new way of doing it. We're learning how computers can do it. So you could do it this way. Or just use the TVM app on the calculator, or on the internet for now. So you end up with, that didn't come out right. That should have been a 4 there, right? So that accidentally, the cursor actually flashed up there. So that should be 4450. I mean, it gave the right answer. It just got blanked out. It was blinking when I did screen copy. There you go. So there's the answer. Oh, what was it? Let me just check that. Was that 44 or was that... Oh, no, it was 5450. I'm sorry. It's 5450. It sounds like a latitude and longitude that we might have had a fight about. 5450. There you go. Brief and complete. Let me go back to the beginning. So that was the debrief of the quiz on 27 April. Shouldn't be any surprises in there.